the whole gospel today. The first John 5:1.
Cool, man.
Learning to hear from the Holy Spirit is fast.
Okay, verse 12, we were looking at, it says, but as many as received him, to them gave him power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And I wrote this in my notes, as many as received him, the greatest thrill is to share Christ with others. The thrill is not how many people you share with. No matter how great or how few, the thrill is sharing the Son. This is the Father's thrill, sharing his Son. And then, as many as received him, of course the word him there has been defined so far. It really isn't, it hasn't, as of yet, it hasn't called him Jesus. We're really going to get into this in verse 14. But as of yet, it hasn't called this him Jesus. As of yet, it hasn't called this him the Son of God. Okay? You have to stick with the context of your Bible. This is where people get off. This is why they don't understand the fullness of what God is saying, because they read into the scriptures instead of sticking with the context. It will mention Jesus Christ here very shortly, but up to this point it has not mentioned the name Jesus Christ. It has stayed with, the Holy Spirit has stayed with his context of what he's talking about, and we should do the same. Okay. God's method of making your son is through his word, but as many as received him, his word. And then verse 13, who were born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Okay, this kind of starts launching us into a little bit different area now, because it talks about receiving him. Okay, so I want to put... let's start over here before the creation. We'll say the first beginning, the real beginning between the Father and the Word, the total thought concept of God. Then you had creation, which is the earth. And on that earth, you had the fall, right, of man. And so you have men on a planet that are fallen creatures. This is the way we think. Now, John has not really come from this aspect so much. He's not trying to bring that out. But this is a, if you will, a fallen person. And he says, and for the first time, he introduces this as many as on this planet, as many as received him. Okay, so this is how we have to view this, who were born, not of the blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. All right, what is receiving him? Now, you can take that a lot of different ways. You can say receiving him, you know, receiving the Savior, receiving him, the Son of God. Receiving him, you know, you can view this in many different ways from this angle. Receiving him, what is him? And you have to define that. But better than me defining it, stick with God's definition. All right. Then, there's another, I mean, you know, we just read these words, but as many as received him. But what does received mean? What does it mean to receive? And so you could pull him out of the context of the beginning, where you're no longer in. You can put him as something that has come later on to salvage the mess brought about by the fall, and call him Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world or sinners. Or you can stick with the context. But if you stick with the context, then you have to say, okay, so you define him. You have to define receive. There's several different ways you can look at receipt. But as many as, of course, we talked about as many as, whosoever will. As many as received. And received what? Received him, but received, all right. What is that received? Okay. If we make him over here the Savior, then we have a fallen creature that will receive the salvation message. Okay? The salvation message. Is that what this is called? With those who received him, the Savior, and the salvation message. Okay? Is it somebody who recognizes that they've got problems, and so they receive him, realizing that he is God, the rightful owner of the creation, the one who wrote the handbook, created us, and therefore would know the best pattern for us to live by. Therefore, we've messed it up. We need God the Creator. No. I'm talking about that. That would be a different him with a different kind of receiving. You understand? There's a different receiving in each case that we talk about. There's whoever you describe can be God creator or God redeemer or, you know, whatever. And the method that's received in each situation is different. Okay? So, you know, I realize that, okay, well, how about him, Lord Jesus Christ. And I recognize that, you know, he is master, and he should be the one. I mean, you know, the servant is not greater than his Lord, but he created it. Well, he's the, you know, he's Lord, and God made him Lord, and I should honor that. Okay. So I receive him. Okay. Once again, with who you decide him is, will change how you receive it. Will determine, literally, how you receive the Lord. This is where you get so much diversity in the church. Because you got people that say, well, Jesus is just Savior, he's Lord. Or, just get saved. Or, you know, God is the rightful master of the universe, he is creator, and therefore his law should be obeyed. But now, every hymn as described as what in the context of what we're reading is not talking about any of these. It is talking about, and we almost have to jump ahead to verse 14, and the Word was made flesh. The Logos, the complete thought and concept of God, was made flesh. Okay? As many as received him are. Now, in his mind, you can say, okay, I receive this as true, this union, this relationship between the Father and the Word, and I can receive that. I can receive that. Okay. But even to do that is not to receive it the way he's talking about right here. I can receive that as true, as an actual thing. I can receive the fact that somehow I'm in the beginning, in the Word, and in union with the Father through the Son, and you through the Son, and therefore I am accepted in the Beloved. Okay. That's one form of receiving, but that's not really what he has in mind here. And he describes what he's got in mind, because see, you can be a lost sinner, you can say, well, I believe things about God, and the basic change that has happened in you is that you have simply believed things that you didn't believe before. That's the basic change. But the Scripture says that as many as received him, to them gave the power to become sons of God, who were born. To receive him is a whole new birth. And that word's been so used that for me to even use that word, for most of us, conjures up our theological viewpoint of what this means. And that's why there's so little life in the church. Because we have theological concepts that we've taken from people instead of actually recognize that we are born of God. Born to those that received him are empowered to become sons of God who are born. You know, this person can receive these truths and not be born again. This person can believe things about God and not be changed, basically. This person can believe that God says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 15, 20 things to do, and he can change his behavior because he will honor the Creator or the Lord, but not be changed in this sense. When I say change, folks, I ain't talking about you changing. And I'm not even in that sense talking about God changing you. I talk about being born. You talk about a change. You're born of another seed. You are totally born again. That is the change. Now all you do is growing. You know what I mean? When a child's born, I mean, they may not be able to drive a car or get a job, da-da-da-da. They may not be able to help dad out on the stuff that he does, but the basic DNA, the basic seed, the basic everything that you need is there once it's born. It just needs to mature. It just needs to mature. But most Christians are not trying to mature hard. Their version of maturity is to mature in the things that you know and the things that you perceive about God. Instead of letting, it's like putting a seed in the ground and letting it eventually grow and go through all the stages that it must grow and go through until it has brought forth fruit, which it surely will. It surely will. I like the version Scott read Sunday morning that says, if you abide in me, if you continue to abide in me, you are bringing forth fruit. You know that if you're abiding in Christ, you are already bringing forth fruit. But here's the problem that we get into. We don't know what fruit. We call it souls, or we call it character, or we call it something else. And I'm telling you that if you are abiding in him, then the fruit is him. He is the fruit, because it is his life that produces it. It is a result of him. It is not anything that you necessarily do, but more importantly, it's not anything that you necessarily see, but the Father sees. The Father sees. That you might be to the praise and the glory of the Father. That you might be to his praise and glory. You know, I remember when my children were little and they'd be on the floor doing this and that stuff. Doing different things, you know. You go in and tuck Natalie into the bed, you know, and she's already crawled up in the bed and everything. And this girl, you know, she's so little, there's no way that she could have ever seen this with me. But she's got the blanket pulled right up to this point, right here. And this is the way she likes to sleep. Well, that's the way I like to sleep. Pull that blanket right up and peer out like this. Come in there and go, you little sweetie, how do you even know this stuff? Well, she doesn't know it. It's in her genes. It's in her. It's the way she is. You know? And you go, you know, I don't know. You know, most of you in here aren't married, so you don't know. But those that have been, or you know, or presently, or watching the video that are, you see things in your kids that pleases you because it is part of what God put in man to continually bring forth. Now, obviously, the spiritual man is all right here. It never did this in the natural. This is what this. That's the shadow. This is the truth. But there's a joy of seeing that proliferate. And God has a joy that's greater than any shadow that anybody could ever experience. And that is, he sees his son. And he sees his son, sometimes, you see, his son is really, really there. And his son does come out of you a lot of times when you don't even know. Because it's life. Not something that grabs you. See, we say, well, his life's in me. So he has to grab me, throw me into the ground, and come forth before I recognize that it's him. Well, I got news for you. And this whole concept of being born, we don't understand. Because in reality, with us, First of all, you gotta understand being born means born in the family. That means God is your father and you are of his seed. You are his son. You are of his seed. You are already that if you're born. Do you do everything that you'll ever do as a son? No, not yet. Does that matter a whole lot to the father at this stage? No. Just that you are has all the promise for him that he needs. For him. Because he knows it. He knows, like any good farmer, you put a seed, an apple seed in the ground, you're going to get apple fruit. Eventually. Right? He also knows that if he, by the power of the Holy Spirit, if you will, if I may put it this way, impregnates you with the Spirit of Christ, that you are going to eventually bring forth the seed. And so, but the problem is that all gets covered over with religion, with our attempts to be something, which is what most people preach. The fruit. Here's the fruit. Go out and do it. So it becomes a copy of fruit, not fruit. You know, that's what I call Christmas tree fruit instead of apple tree fruit. Christmas tree fruit looks real good, but it's not alive. Apple tree fruit comes as a result of life. We put on all this stuff. And then, we've actually made it harder to know the truth of releasing this life that is already there, because we, frankly, there's a lot of different reasons, but, you know, it's like, we want to grow up so fast. You know, a lot of it goes back to this old pride factor, and I hate to say that, but it really does. Even though we're born in that scene, we don't want people to see whatever flaws that we've got. And so, we want to cover over that. We may not call it covering over, we may call it growth, but it's not growth, it's growth in how to act Christian. You know what I mean? But it's not true growth. It's growth in hypocrisy in a certain sense. Now the motivation behind that is everything. Because many times our motivation is to cover up and look good and cover it up. Some people, it may not be to cover up and look good, maybe you get ahead. Well, you know, I mean, I was this way in the world. I was trying to get ahead in the world. I was doing real good in the world. Now I'm a Christian. I want to proceed ahead and I want to push ahead and I want to be way ahead in Christianity. And I want to be something. I want to be successful or whatever, and that's why this success thing got so big here for a while. It's not as big as it was, but it got real big and people jumped on the bandwagon. It was feeding nothing but their flesh. And most of those people were not growing in Christ. They were growing in putting on all this stuff so that it could look a certain way to everyone else, and somebody said, oh, that looks good, that looks good, that looks, let's promote you to something. And then, now, this stuff never got remedied on the inside because there was no true growth. They wouldn't let true growth come, which means, you know, when you put a seed in the, you know, when you put a seed in the ground, the outer shell begins, the outer shell, I don't know if you notice, that's what the dying process is, the outer shell disintegrates. But that's good because of the inner life, what's called the germ. Now, I don't know if you knew this, but see, here's your seed. But a seed is not just a little dot, man. There's an inner thing called the germ, which contains the life, and the outer, which is the shell. When you put that thing underground, the elements of this world and everything begin to have an effect on it, and it begins to crumble and decay. And at first, when you look at it, you go, oh my God, this is not progress, this is regress. But it cannot bring forth fruit except it die. Because the life is the inward man. The outward man, we have to die to the outward man. We have to die to its views. We have to, and the good thing is God says it must fall into the ground and die. It has to be buried, put away, it's not exalted, it's not made better. It's the same principle as the vessel, you know, you've got the vessel here, you've got the treasure in it, you know. We have this treasure, and the treasure is what's beautiful, but we sit there and work on the vessel, the outward man, ignoring the inward man. And so when we see a problem with the outward, we want to fix the cracks instead of realizing that, you know, somebody might actually, through your weakness, this is hard, but it's the truth, through your weakness, actually see Christ. Man, I know, I can promise that almost every one of you seen Christ in me at a point that my greatest weakness, but you didn't know that it was my weakness. I knew it, and I wasn't trying to hide it. But you never perceived that that was a point of weakness, and Christ came forth, because I couldn't. I had no strength. I had no ability, and I had to trust the Lord, and the Lord came forth. You saw it, you thought, wow, what a strong guy, when in reality, it was my weakness is what allowed him to be able to come out. A crack happened when I was recording, you know, it's just you and your life, and I don't have the ability, and all of a sudden, the Lord would come forth. But that's contrary. We think in terms of strength. God thinks in terms of weakness. We think in terms of life. God thinks in terms of death. We think in terms of gain. God thinks in terms of loss. Because if you seek to save, you lose. If you give mercy, give it. You get mercy. Loss. Gain. If you know what I'm saying? But, you know, we're waiting for everybody else to shape up and give them mercy, and then I'll show some mercy. Which means when we gain it, then we'll give. When I have sufficient for me, you know, then I'll give. And you check all the scriptures. I mean, Elijah said, go join yourself to this widow over here. Man, what a test. What a test. You know, there's a famine in the land. He walks up to the widow's house because he'd been under the brook where the water had flown, and ravens had brought him food every day, you know. God told him to go there, you know, and there's famine in the land. He said, famine's coming because you know, ungodly king and ungodly nation. So famine comes, and he's sitting there drinking at the brook, and ravens feed him, and all of a sudden, the brook dries up, and the ravens quit coming. And he goes, what do I do, Lord? You know, I mean, you know, there's this famine because of their unrighteousness, and I'm living righteous, and what's the deal? And he says, go join yourself to a widow. So I'm sure he went just like any of us, go, oh, good provision. He gets there, and she's got the last little bit of oil that they're going to have for a meal and a cake. They're going to have it and then die because that's all she's got. Now, I'm sure he thought he was going to join into a house that had all this food and stuff and this abundance, which is the way we always think, abundance. Fill me up, and I'll be able to help. See? And so he comes and joins, and she tells him the story. And thank God, faith arose in his heart. He says, give me to eat. God, that, let me tell you something. For an unselfish man, that takes a lot of guts. It takes a lot of trust, actually, to the Lord. For an unselfish, to say that to a widow and her son, you give me the last bit? Oh, man, you know, for a selfish part of it, yeah, you give me, you know, it's easy. It's exactly what they would say. No test there. It's according to their nature. Yeah, give me, take care of me. I'm God's man. You die tough, you know. I mean, at least the word of God will come on. But for an unselfish man, it's like, oh, Lord, man, no. Well, okay. I know the principle, and I know my God, and I know how he works. So you give to me. Okay? He started pouring the oil, and it just kept pouring. And he said, while he was pouring, get every vessel in the house. She went and got all the vessels, and they started getting full. So go out into the neighborhood and borrow everybody else's vessels. And he just kept pouring. Well, as far as she was concerned, she gave it as if, well, okay, if you're God's man, and this is the way it's supposed to be, here, take it. She poured out. When she did, God increased. And that's the way God is. So, well, okay. But to pour out, to lose, to break down, to break open, we don't see, that's why we don't understand. new birth. We couldn't possibly understand the new birth as God means it. Really? I mean, I'm just being honest. I mean, we couldn't really, because new birth means we have an incorruptible life, or what the other scripture describes as this treasure in earthen vessels. Okay? And we have, I love that. You know, first of all, we consist the body. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. So we, vessels, so it's one, we, that many, but the many are one. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the excellency of the power may be of God, not of the vessel. That answers it if we believe that, if we just ever believe that once. You know what I mean? I mean, just believe that once for all. I'm talking about this is the way God says to believe. Believe it once for all. Once and for all. That's literally in the Greek. It says that many times when it says it. In literal Greek, it's saying once and for all. Okay? So if you believe that about him, you believe, okay, if I fall in the ground and die, somebody says, that's bad. No, that's good. That's good. Because what's going to come forth? But the question is, do we know what we have by the new covenant? Do we know what we have? And if we know what we have, there is nobody can pluck you out of his hand. There is nobody that can rob you. There is nobody that can take from you, that God, the great judge of the universe, the just one, will see to it that if you do it in the right spirit, you know, somebody said, Randy, you know, poor thing, you know, we had all this stuff stolen down at Mardi Gras, the Dolans got their insurance and took care of them, Kelly got hers, everybody did, you're the only one that didn't get anything. I said, I didn't get anything back because, you know, as soon as they stole my stuff, I gave it to them. Here, I just give it to you. You can't rob me. Take it. And God has already begun to provide most of the stuff I was missing, not through insurance, but just here and there, this and that. But if he didn't, he didn't rob me because I gave it. I didn't let you steal it. They didn't murder Jesus. Jesus laid down his life. We'll murder you. You can't even argue, give my life, you know. You understand that principle, but you've done it in the opposite. You know, you're fired. You can't fire me. I quit. Same principle, but different spirit. Okay, so I really do believe that the new birth, because the new birth is, 1 Peter 1:23, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible by the what? Hold on, concept of God. See, I just keep wanting to jump into that because that's coming up here in verse 14. And you almost can't say what I'm saying without really emphasizing what you have received. But what you have received is the Word of God. I mean, there's almost no way that you can not just go ahead and spell that out, because it says, who were born. Not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. All right. Somebody received the Word, not the Scriptures, the Word, the total thought and concept of the Father, and that they are in the beginning with Him. Somebody received that, and God says, the result of receiving that. Now think about this. When you received the Lord, did you really think greatly in terms of, boom, my whole life is dead and I'm born into a new family now and I have a whole new everything? Didn't you think more in terms of that you were a sinner and you did some things wrong and now you're forgiven? Basically. Isn't that the basic gist of that? God deals with it, and he says, when you receive me, you are born anew. Whether you fully understand that or not, you're born anew. The because, now here's, with us, it's walking along one day and then I realize my need, so I cry out. That's how it works for us. Okay, but let's look how it works for God. He starts out here, and he hasn't even created anything. He's just got the Father and his total thought and concept called his Son. That's what he's got. Then all things are created by him and for him and to him and through him, and by him all things consist. You know what I mean? Total thought and concept created this all in relationship to him. Then it puts little people on there and they fall, and it comes into a darkened, fallen state. And on that planet, there are people who finally cry out for a Savior that has come to help them. That's kind of the way it is for us. But for him, he built everything based on this. And so he says, okay, this is not this. This is not this. If this was really good, it would not be this. The Word, the total thought concept. So what does he do? He says, and I'm drawing down here on his level, here's the Father, here's the Word. He says, this fallen thing, this, whether it's yucky or not, it's not this. But if it was good, it would be this. Is not suitable. So I'm going to send the Word. It's going to be made flesh and dwell among you. And then he's going to die, but he's not just going to die for you. He's going to take you to the cross. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live in a mile of man is crucified. He's going to take you, the old creation, to the cross. And then he is going to rise. He who? The Word. And he's going to call that a new creation because for you, it's new. For him, it always was, and is, and is to come. Okay. But for you, it's new. Okay. And where do you end up? In him. But what is that? This is nothing more than the Word being made flesh, coming down here and accomplishing the putting away of anything but this, so that this might be reestablished. You see that? Now, I'm trying to let you see it from God's point of view. He doesn't see, I've got this problem, and I'm really trying, and he's got one thought concept, and that's Christ, the Logos. And he goes, so everyone that receives this off of this, he implants this incorruptible seed in them, but he doesn't just put it in them on this planet. He brings them through death, because there has to be a putting away of the old. Now, you can be born again. You see that? We see it all happening over here, and somehow we're going to end up in heaven somehow with God. And he goes, no, this is taken to the cross, the old creation is put away, and now there is a new creation. And you have not only been placed in the new creation, but you have been born of an incorruptible seed, which is Christ. Now, if every Christian would begin to just acknowledge that and understand that, we change the world. Because we are of God. You are of God, little children, and have overcome the world, for greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Does that sound a little different than maybe it ever did before? You are of God, little children, and have, we've been working, have, I understand, have, overcome the world, for greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. Do you see it? You know, we go, yeah, he's greater, he's tougher, he's meaner, he can do it. No. He's greater than this, so I put this away and now there's only that. We're still fighting a lot of stuff over here on the death side of the cross, on the side of the cross, the pre-cross side. And he's going, the devil is defeated through the cross. That through death, he might destroy. The word destroy there means to render inoperative. Him that hath the power of death, that is the devil, through death. Okay. The old man is crucified. Take up your cross daily in relationship to your soul. The cross is the answer. I am crucified to the world crucified to me. If anybody preaches cross stuff all the time, why don't you give us something that will help us? You mean go back up to this masking over kind of thing? And it'll matter. on, it'll work for a while. And I can tell you what, there are a lot of churches that come and go, and if the Lord delays his coming, you'll get to see it. A lot of churches will come, and they'll bluster, and they'll carry on, and we've got it, and what you need to do is what we're doing, and jump on the bandwagon, boom, 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 and everybody will jump on the bandwagon. Folks, that bandwagon will go only so far, and it'll break down, and many of those people's lives will be torn apart, messed up, and certainly the church and the whole thing. But you know what? Because it's based on something other than what God has in his heart. You say, well, we must be special that we've been able to, you know, Deb and I were talking, that we went to Berean, and we went to Shiloh, and Berean went 7 years, and Shiloh went 7 years, and here in just a few years, we will have gone as long as both of those put together. It must be something very special about us. I think it still goes back to this father's concept in relationship to his son. Never leaving that. Never. Never leaving that. Because if that is what the way it is in the heart of the father, you cannot go wrong. You know, people will say, I want God to bless what I'm doing. Hey, find out what's important to God. He'll bless that. Is that cool? Jerry, you have your hand up, Doc.
Yeah, I was just thinking that that had to been, regardless of Adam and Paul, that had to been God's plan, eternal plan, because even Adam, before he fell, wasn't what God was wanting. Somewhere along the line, the cross was, had to come into place somewhere.
Right. Absolutely.
It's not just something that, the cross is just something that came into play because of Adam. Somewhere, even Adam and Paul, the cross had to be there. Bring us into Christ.
Right. That's right. And a new birth still has to, would have had to take place, because Adam was not a son of God by being the seed of God. He was a creation of God, but he was not the son of God by being born of his own seed of his seed. You know what I'm saying? He had not been born of the seed of God. God breathed life into him. God, you know, gave life to animals and stuff too, but it was not, he was not of the seed of God. And whether he was in, whether he was in sin or he never failed, he would still have needed a new birth, which would have required a death. And I'm not going to get into why it requires a death, but I can just say that the nature of God is different. The one sitting on the throne right now is a lamb. And there are many, many offerings in the Old Testament that are not for sin. You know, we always think, well, I have to, you know, Jesus had to die for sin, or I have to offer for sin. There are many offerings that were given, and nobody did anything wrong. God established those because it's the way his nature is. He is a giver, and there ain't no little bitty penny in there, I'll throw you something to feel better about it, I'll say it.
I've talked to some
somebody the other day, and they were saying, they said, man, I used to really care about the Lord. I used to really put the Lord first. I used to really, I didn't sin very much, and now I sin all the time. And I just find myself going back into it so easy. And now I almost have to bring conviction. I used to have conviction that easy. Now I'm not even convicted. I don't even care. You know, in fact, you know, I know I'm going to sin some more, and I don't even care. I'm just, and they really, in a certain sense, they, you know, had kind of an attitude of, you know, man, where's God? And, you know, how can I pray and God don't help me? And da da da, and all this kind of stuff. And I said, well, you know, God's right there. But, no, he ain't. You know, da 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 da. Say what you want, carry on, get upset, but God's right there. I didn't have to convince them. This person, you know, just felt like God had left them, and they just felt like they had thrown everything to the wind and just went, hey, I'm going to sin. You know, God ain't. And I don't feel conviction anymore. But they were sitting right there talking to me. And I knew absolutely why they were there. They were there because they cared. Didn't matter what they said. Didn't matter what attitude they had at the moment. They were there because they cared. And I sat there and I watched the life of the Lord work in. It didn't solve the problems that they were having, but I watched the life of the Lord. And they can sit there and say, well, I'm just going to blatantly sin, or where is God? I don't even like God anymore. I don't even believe you preaching whatever you just go. If you see the life in there, you can go, carry on, red, do whatever you want. Yeah, God's a flake, ain't he? You know, you can join in. You know, most of the time you don't. You know what I mean? Most of the time you go, my God, don't take that way. Hold your tongue. You know, and all this, you know. And you know, you're teetering on the edge of hell. You know. And so I'll just go, hey, you know, that's fine. You know, I understand exactly how you feel. You're going to feel the way that you feel right now. It's obvious that you're caught up in this thing right now. But I want you to know something. Jesus does love you regardless of what you say. And the Lord is going to show that he is there to you. Sooner or later, it's going to happen. And I want you to just remember, you talk to a lot of people, people tell you all this stuff. I want you to remember the words of somebody that does know the Lord. That you will eventually know him again in the way that you're talking about. But he wants you to know him in a different way than I'm talking about, not going by feelings and whatever. Because the main feel was that I hadn't felt the Lord in a long time. Well, oh, would you like to feel the Lord? That was the Lord. Oh, thank God. You know, you think they do that. Oh, thank God I did it. You know, it's they want to feel good. That's what they want. Good feelings, and that's their Lord. You know what I'm saying? That is their Lord. When their Lord isn't there, where's the Lord? They call the Lord good feelings. But the Lord is there all the time. And he was there. He was really there. But they didn't sense it there at all. I just gave them confidence. I said, well, can you have confidence in anybody? I mean, do you kind of have a little bit of confidence in me? Well, that's one on me. Well, good. Lord's with you. You're all right. You're freaking out right now. Your emotions are going off the deep end, whatever, and you're going with it, whatever. That's fine. You can do that. Go for a walk, you know? But let me tell you, you're going to be back on track. You're going to know the Lord. You're going to keep on going. You're going to pick up. You're going to find that God was always there. Okay? Well, I said, I didn't say. Figured out. I said, can you trust somebody? Just dying in. You know, well, I'm going to pray for you. I thought you hated God.
Stuff like it happens in my life, you know, in my life, you know, the Lord, you know, it's, you know, I,
That don't happen anymore, it's the point it used to.
Yeah. But it still happens, though. But it still happens. And, you know, it's just like, you know, I don't see that, you know, Lord, you know, this is, you know, working for my good to begin with. You know, it's gonna be turned around, you know, not my good, but the Lord's good. You know, it's gonna be turned around for his good. You know, if we don't see it as a growing process,
right.
You know, that these things are happening because number one, you need to grow, number two, you need to mature, you know, it's like, you know, it's bringing us to maturity, it's learning, we're learning patience, you know, many things that we're learning through situations and circumstances, but we jump to the first thing, you know, and not even, the Lord is not even the issue at that point, when we jump to the first thing, you know, so we're not even thinking about the Lord, we're thinking about the circumstances, what's going on.
It's interesting how John's wording there, and I can't help but jump to that next scripture again, but it talks about verse 13, we were born, then it talks about the Word being made flesh. Okay, now I don't believe that this is just and only a reference to the incarnation. I believe that there is this Father and this relationship, I would like to link it, if I can, between what each one calls his son the Word, his total body concept. So we draw a person, and we'll make this one a little thicker here so we can put Jesus on the inside of him. And so what we're not aware of is what we've been born of, and that is this incorruptible seed that we receive, which is the Word of God. As James 1:18, I think, says that, and it's very similar to the scripture that we're reading. Of his own will begotten, yes, with the Word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. That we should be of his kind. He brings forth after his kind. Okay, so we have received, and let me draw a word here like the shape of this heart, just so that you can see that it's not just something different, it is the same. It is the same word. It is the same complete thought concept. Okay, we've been born of this, it is in us. And it's the same. It's not different. It's the same. It is the love of his heart. It is the complete thought. It is the son of his dear love. It is, you know, always, this is my beloved son. Now, this is the one, he's the big creator, he's the guy, man, you guys are all failures, but my son will do it. You know, he refers in every context to his son in a dear type of manner, because that is his relationship with his son. That is his relationship. I don't care what you... Your relationship with God may not be what it ought to be, but it is. It's better than what it ought to be. It's built on this, as far as God's side. But you don't know that because you don't know his heart towards this. So, when you don't know that, it is as if you have not been born again, or born of incorruptible seed, born of the Word of God. Being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible seed, by the Word of God which liveth. The Word, the Logos. By the Logos of God which liveth and abideth forever. The same. So it says, being born again, not corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God which liveth. By the Word. Okay, both of the scriptures we've referred to, or all three of them we've referred to, have referred the new birth to this Word, this Logos. Okay, so we act as if we have not been born again. Once again, that means absolutely nothing unless you know that we've been born of this, that which was from the beginning, and is always in the heart of the Father. So, we feel there's a breakdown between us and God because we didn't do something, or we did do something that we shouldn't have done, and that negates everything in our minds because, frankly, most of us have a legalistic relationship with God. It is, if I do this, I then he will love me. It's the law. The law says you do this, I'll love you. Do this, I'll love you. You do this, that'll do it. The new one, which we'll see, he's, this one that came, the Word of God, was made manifest, is full of grace. Unmerited favor. He's full of it, and that's where you were blessed. He's full of grace and truth. You were blessed. Okay, so we feel that there's, it's as if we're not born again. But the Father has an undying relationship with His Son, which is in us. So He doesn't view us in the mess-ups that we do and all this so much as He views us by Christ. He knows that our flesh is flesh, and He knows that all the, you know, so it just makes you want to read the Scripture. Start really talking about the Lord. Listen to this. For all flesh is like grass, and all the glory of man like the flower of grass. The grass withers, and its flower fades away. But the word of the Lord endures forever. And this is the word which by the gospel is preached unto you. Now, where is that found? Just after it says, being born again, not incorruptible seed, but an incorruptible seed. God knows the weakness of the flesh. And if we at times go by the flesh, is God surprised that the flesh was the flesh? Is He shocked that the flesh acted like the flesh? Is He shocked that the flesh is weak through the flesh? Or that the law is weak through the flesh? That we can't keep the law, here's the problem with stuff. We can't keep the law. We can't, have you ever said, I can't keep that? And He goes, I know. I've always known that if I'm before you were, every flesh that ever came along for a picture. I know. We are the ones that are surprised. And here's why. Number one, we have not truly understood the new birth, that it is the Word that liveth in the heart of the Father and abides forever. That's the seed we've been born in. Alright? And the other thing is that we have put more emphasis on the outward than being in and that which is in us. That I'm in Him, He is in me, I'm accepted in the Beloved. What did you do wrong? I did some things wrong, and those deeds may not be accepted, but those deeds are not me. And those deeds need to be put under the blood that Jesus shed for those deeds. So thank God for the blood in relationship to my actions, but in relationship to me, it was the cross, and I am crucified, even if I'm not acting like it, because I'm going by things of the flesh, things of the world. That doesn't change the cross to God the Father. And this is what you don't understand. It changes everything to you, but it doesn't change anything to God the Father. Jesus died, and when He died, He didn't just die for the fun of it. He died to put your flesh to death. And as far as He's concerned, the old man is crucified. Now, if you tend to go by the tendencies of the flesh, that does not circumvent what Jesus did on the cross. That does not circumvent the death, the resurrection. Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father. He's seated there because He did a legal work that took care of all sins. He could not have sat down if the work was not finished. But you act like it's not finished. But Jesus could never, if we're not, God is too righteous and too just. Jesus could not have sat down in the throne room of heaven unless all sin and all iniquity and all problems were fully dealt with. Because to sit down means the work is finished. And He could never have done that. God, in His holiness and everything, would not have allowed a halfway, half-hearted, and slipshod job of the thing to be allowed into the throne room because it would have perverted everything from the throne, from the head right on down. So it had to be done. And guess what? It is done. Now, He says, okay, now, acknowledge it. Acknowledge the problem. Acknowledge the blood. Well, that doesn't take away the problem. No, it doesn't. But this is why this we must grow in the relationship we have here first. We started that some months back by saying, no, that God is for you. Now we're telling you why. He is for you. He is always for you. He cannot turn his back on his son, and he can't turn his back on you because you two are one. Okay? So, but then, as you continue to grow in the reality of the Christ that you are in, as you abide in that, he begins to abide in you, then you're not going by the flesh. Guess what? You know, you take a branch that's going, and you know, you pull a weed up out of here, and you throw it out there on the ground, pull it up by the roots, throw it out there on the ground. You can come back days later, and it still looks like it's still alive. I've done that. When's that thing going to die? It's been there for days. You know? It died the minute I pulled it up. Just didn't look like it. But if you understand, if its roots are in the dirt, it's done. But we go, well, I'm going to see it all shriveled up and dead before I will believe. You know? And when we do believe, a lot of times we're just justifying our sin. Oh, I believe. Well, I believe this is dead. He'll continue sin. Oh, it's dead. Yeah, it's dead. I'm dead in Christ. You know, people just make excuses. But a true believer will go, the principle is right. The cross in it, thing uprooted. Jesus put the axe to the root. You know, John said that. Hey, I'm coming. I'm baptizing in water. That ain't going to do it. I tell you what, there's one coming after me. He's going to put the axe to the root. Jesus came. Jesus put the axe to the root. Axe is to the root. I died with him. I'm raised up, seated at the right hand of God. In union with him, and therefore in union with the Father, my relationship is now understood through Christ. Oh, Jesus, you failed today. Well, Father, I guess I'm not in relationship with you because Jesus did. But Jesus didn't fail. My relationship is through Christ. My relationship is not built on what I'm doing. Now, because of the blood, because of the Holy Spirit, he convicts me of my deeds, and I go to the blood. And he didn't say, walk in there like some child that has been kicked out of the family and forsaken and go, please receive me back so I don't go to hell. No, that's the way you did it when you first got saved. Please receive. Now he says, come boldly to the throne of grace and find help in time of need. I sinned, I messed up, I shouldn't be going by the flesh. I need to learn how to do it. And you know what? If you really, really learn what is Christ and what is the flesh, you won't do it. Most of you won't. Really. You won't. That's why I believe the commandments are true, that I shall not kill. Because you just won't. Yeah. But we've received him, but we have not become sons of God. But we're becoming sons of God. So as many as received him have that right. And that's what God's heart is, so that this all works in conjunction together. And really, it's all the same. It's all one. It's all one. Your relationship is continually built on this and the work of the cross. So it is the person of Christ as understood by the Father, and the work of the cross, the work of Christ and him crucified, as understood by you. So that you enter in as a son by the Son, and then you continually keep the fullness of that relationship flowing by the blood that flows and cleanses. It's always at work. And unless you come to perfection in this lifetime, and I don't know anybody really that's done that, you're probably going to need the blood constantly. I believe it's a provision made by one that is full of grace and truth. And when you don't have the truth, and the truth ain't working in you, you better love grace. Is that right? He's full of grace and truth. And if you don't know the truth, and the truth ain't fully got you, and you're not fully flowing with it, then you better know about grace. And what do you know about truth? You're walking in it. See, what about all the other areas that aren't even factors in your life? Because you've learn the truth. You don't even remember those. Do you know what I'm talking about? You've gotten down the road so far, you don't even remember the areas that you're walking in truth every day. Every day you're walking in truth in certain areas, and you've got the victory. The enemy can't touch you. Flesh can't touch you. You're walking with the Lord. It's not a factor at all. But you don't remember those. So all you remember is what you've done recently. You know, I saw this cartoon once, and this son standing there, and his mom's old and gray. He says to her, "Yeah, I know, Mom. But what have you done for me lately?" It's kind of the way we are with the Lord. You know, we're going, "Well, you know, but I haven't done anything lately." He goes, "Well, if you haven't and you can't walk in truth in that area, I am the Word made flesh. You better, and I'm full of grace and truth. Walk in the truth of God. Walk in the light of the grace. Don't make void the grace of God. The blood is there. I tell, I'm the one." And God, the Father will tell you this. I'm the one that says, "Come boldly." I'm the one that put you in, my son. I'm the one that did all this. I did it. I love you. I'm for you. Be bold. Be strong. For the Lord thy God is with you. I want to sing all the songs that we sing. You know, we need to quit singing and start living. You know, but you know, if we just had like a worship service 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, well, we'd all have a victory, would we? No. Because we need to quit singing. Or we need to start singing what we believe. So, this is a wonderful provision. It totally covers everything, so much so that Jesus ascended back up and went, died on the cross, came in us, ascended back up, seated at the right hand of the Father. The Father says, "Work is done, it's finished, it's settled, okay. Believe it, Holy Spirit, go tell them the truth." You know, we go, and our whole lives are wrapped and rolling, and you know, he's going, you know, and the Holy Spirit's going, you know, and we're going, "Yeah, but what about these things? They keep happening." Well, 2 years ago, those things weren't the big issue in your life. I think about today. There's people left this church 2 years ago. The problems that we had aren't even there anymore. The problems they left over, not even there. In fact, I've got new things to find the truth, lay hold of the truth, live in accord with the truth, till we all come. Till we all come. You know? So the gospel is the truth. This is our gospel. This is the one we preach. This is the one we can go to anybody in any shape and tell them, "Boldly, hey, man, it's done, it's finished, but there's provision for the areas that you haven't fully laid hold of, and you will. Just keep on going, and the truth will increase, and increase, and increase, and increase." Thank God it's all covered by grace. Sat down and God said, "I'm pleased." We're there and he says, "Sit down and shut up."
Sure.
Yeah, you know, I think a lot of the problem lies in the fact that instead of abiding in the truth of Christ and his relationship with the Father, we get confused and mixed up all of the other truths of this Father and try and apply them to this Father-Son relationship.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And what's once again is that concept of separateness, where we think we that the relationship that we have with God is based on us. And it's not. And God is so wise. The Father is so wise. And he cared so much to make this foolproof and failure-proof for those that would believe. You know, I love those scriptures in Ephesians. And, you know, you've heard me quote them many times, but they are powerful. It's not just words. It is so powerful. He says, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what is the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us
who believe.
According to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him up from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places, far above all, principalities and powers and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in the world to come. Oh, but would you help me, Lord? Could you give me some help? Hello? And hath put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him that filleth all in all.
Yeah, but I mean, today I don't really feel good. You know, people are getting some feelings.
You know, and this is all, this is what we call the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. This is what we believe. This is what we believe. And because we believe this, we're in the family of God. We're Christians. This is what, this is the difference. They don't have that. They don't know that. We do. And we're in union with that. We are one with that. This isn't something that happened 2,000 years ago. This is what is ours today by virtue of his work, his son. And all we have to do is by faith receive grace, which is built and based on this. And that's all.
When I was in Toronto, there was a young man that stood and gave, told him a vision that he had. And so it went right straight into my spirit, you know, as this was before. And part of that had to do with his seeing the bride of Christ as an old, wrinkled woman. And with face all wrinkled up. And the Lord, he said, was showing him that he was renewing the bride back to this, the young, you know, making her getting her ready. And I never thought of the wrinkles as applying to the face, you know what I mean? He said the thing that had made her old were the law and the commandments. And I went, oh my goodness, which means then that the thing that's going to renew her youth is going to be the grace and the understanding of, to me, was the cross. That she's relieved of the law and the commandments. And I don't know that he understood everything he was saying, but he did say that the thing that had made her old and wrinkled was the law and the commandments. But God was renewing the bride's youth, and I thought, that's not a prophetic vision. And I mean, it just stays there, you know. There's another
which part. Which makes me happy, too. You know, constantly. I mean, there's joy unspeakable. Full of glory. And just, you know, I mean, it will keep you. You know, you don't have to be doing backflips to have joy. You know that? But I don't know that I've ever lost this joy. You know, they would say the joy of the Lord is your strength. And what we mean is a good feeling that we can, so we can jump around. It feels good. You know, but I mean, you know, that's why most of people don't have strength, you know, after they quit shouting. But in reality, there is a joy that will give you strength and
when everything is bad around you, and you can't find joy in anything else. You know, when Jesus hung on that cross, for the joy, not of the moment, but the joy that was set before him. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for your son. Thank you for placing us in the middle and relating to us by Christ. We love you, Father, and we don't fully know this, but we want to know. Holy Spirit, teach us. Make it reality so that we can live by us.